Good morning, everybody. I'm Dave Weiner. Welcome to the Brass Bench. This is episode 2. On my left, your right, Jacob Medlin of Medlin Horns.
Hello.
So this is our ongoing conversation about brass instrument manufacture, maintenance, modification, and repair. And Jacob is the manufacturer part of it today. So we'll get to that. Let's get through a few things. Other than that, you can find everything else you want to know about the show at www.thebrassbench.com. Thebrassbench.com. Include that definite article in there. Or on our Facebook page, same name. So this is a conversation, and I hope everybody who's watching will join in. Welcome to everybody who's chatting with us. Thanks for coming. Glad to have you here. One of the things I noticed last week was that we had way more views of the archive than we did live, which indicates a lot of people are checking in with the archive, and that's great. Thank you very much. Glad to have all of you on board as well. The people who are watching live can chat with us interactively, but the people who are watching the archive, if you want to interact with us, you have to send us an email, obviously, and please do, to you guys at thebrassbench.com. That's YOUGUYS at thebrassbench.com. It's not exactly interactive, but you can send us topics you'd like us to discuss, send us questions and that sort of thing, and we'll watch for those. And as you can see, we have a lot of stuff on the bench here. Jacob is going to talk about making horns, which he does. He's going to talk about making coffee, which he does. The horns he makes for a living, the coffee he makes to live. And that's what we're going to do.
Hang on.
Making a little noise here.
Yeah. Are you?
We have to grind the beans. Okay, sorry, I just had to, while Jacob was grinding the coffee beans there, he's making pour-over coffee.
For you, Dave.
Yeah, well, for me. He's making it into my mug. Anything you want to share with us about your pour-over coffee right now?
I
see live now.
Okay.
I'm talking with our director, Adam. Adam Weiner is my director, and if you hear a voice that doesn't belong to a body, that voice is Adam behind the scenes. And he is he's doing all the technical stuff. So if for some reason you have an issue with the sound or the audio or anything, please chat to us. Say something to us in the little chat box there. It's pretty self-explanatory. I'm sure you know how to do it. Let us know that you're having a problem with what you see or what you hear or both. Adam can fix those issues on the fly usually. So, while Jacob's making me some pour-over coffee, do you want to explain your process at all before I go on to the news?
Well, why don't I just make you a cup of coffee while you say the news, and that way we can actually start this.
You can't imagine how much I want you to do that.
I know exactly how much you want me to do that.
Okay. So, last week I went on and on and on about the brass events, and I'm not going to do that. I'm going to read you the major ones, though. The big ones from the big societies, and maybe a couple others. So, number one, if you're a trumpet player, I'm sorry, if you're a tuba or euphonium player, iTech 2016 is coming up. It's going to be at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville, Tennessee, and that's May 30th to June 4th. And there's going to be a theme to that one. It's going to be Foundations in Pedagogy. So look for the ITEA website for that conference. May 31st through June 4th, the International Trumpet Guild Conference is going to be at the Hyatt Regency in Anaheim, California. Go to the Trumpet Guild's website to find out more information about that. June 8th through June 11th, the International Trombone Festival 2016 is going to be at the Juilliard School of Music in New York, New York, June 8th to 11th. And finally, the last major show from a major organization of the season is the International Horn Symposium. It will be June 13th to June 18th at Ithaca College, Ithaca, New York. Go to the International Horn Society's website. I'm going to give a little plug for stuff I'm doing. DC Horn Day is at Catholic University of America at the Benjamin T. Rome School of Music on the campus of Catholic U in Washington, D.C. That's Sunday, June 5th. I'll be there exhibiting and I'll be presenting. And the last one I'm going to do this year is audition, or this season, this is Audition Mode Seminar. That's Denise Tryon and Carl Pittock's seminar for preparing people for their auditions, obviously. They're going to have a vendor day this year, so one day. That's June 19th to 24th, but the vendor day will be Wednesday, June 22nd. And one more thing I want to mention, because it came through someone asked me specifically, and that's Susan McCulloch of the Lamont School of Music at the University of Denver. Mentions that the Rafael Mendez Brass Institute is coming up. That's going to be July 10 to 16 at the Lamont School of Music in Denver, Colorado. And find out about that at the Mendez Brass Institute. The important note is that there are scholarships available up to $500, which I don't think covers it completely. I don't know about that. Check on that. But it's a considerable amount of the tuition. So,
great.
How about that coffee?
Well, Dave, like all good things, you gotta wait for it.
Okay. Well,
it's almost done.
Like Inigo Montoya. I hate waiting.
I'm sure you do.
But it's worth waiting for. I've had Jacob's pour over coffee.
This is a delightful Ethiopian Idito coffee from a local roaster that we have in Durham,
okay,
North Carolina.
That's cool.
So,
are we going to roast any of the local stuff I brought today? Or I mean, not roast it, pour it.
Sure. I mean,
I need that coffee.
You need this. You need this coffee, and you need to drink it, and then
I need that in my body.
And then you need to make another decision.
All right. So, Jacob, I'm going to introduce Jacob again, since he is my guest today, my featured guest, and friend of the show, friend of the shop. Jacob is a horn maker. You make what some people call French horns.
Yes, I do make French horns.
And we have an example of his work on the bench. Yeah. I'm going to ask my director if that's in sight from the overhead cam.
Oops.
We got to move that into sight. We'll do that after we make the coffee, after we get that stuff out of the way. We'll bring one of his, he's got one of his horns.
Oh, dear.
Look at that. It's beautiful.
So,
go ahead.
I really like this. This brewing method, because I really like brighter coffees, a little bit more flowery.
Excuse me, folks. I'm just gonna sip my coffee.
More citrus flavors, a little bit more on the upper end, less of the chocolate, less of the spinach flavors.
Pull your mic in just a bit, I think.
How about I just lean in like that?
Lean in. I just was worried that when you turned to me, you know, people won't hear the very important things you have to tell.
Well, Dave, I'm not used to being interviewed by celebrities, so I'm not sure.
I'm not used to being a celebrity.
I don't have the whole thing down yet.
Nor do I.
So the pour over is going to give you a lot more of the, you know, if you did the same coffee in like a French press or
right.
for something like that, you'd get a lot more of the chocolate, like
the chocolate,
the deeper
notes.
Flavors, yeah,
the notes,
yeah. Yeah.
Do you do
this
that?
A bright coffee or if this is a bright coffee or a dark coffee, Dave?
This seems bright to me. It's African, I can tell you that. He told me that.
I did tell him that. So, yeah. No, but you know the other thing I really like is you can do coffee all day
mm-hmm.
in a pot, you can do it all sorts of ways. But you know, this method really it's a little bit meditative. In the mornings, it's got a nice flow to the routine, and it's also, you know, it's something else that rewards you for practice.
Okay.
The more you practice, the better you get. And I don't know, I'm sort of I find those kinds of things.
So you heat the water and you pour it over. That's, I mean, everybody understands it. Now, you have a special grinder that you like to use.
Well, I mean, this is obviously not special. And anyone who knows coffee would sort of sniff at this particular one.
Oh, but I see. It's not expensive enough.
Right. So this is a burr grinder. So unlike the blades, it sort of just pulverizes.
Yeah, which is what I do. Right. Yeah, pulverize it.
Pulverize it. This has like gears. It's sort of... It's going to crush it, sort of like a gravel crusher.
Okay.
With the whole idea that, you know, you set it to get a certain size of...
But it's a more even size of grind. Because I find when I put my beans in my, like, blade grinder, that there's always, like, one or two beans that just, like... They just happily float on top and let all the others take it from the team. And they just hang out and let the other ones get chopped to bits.
Well,
I
used to live with a guy, one of my old roommates, who would make coffee like this in the morning, but had a blade grinder, and he would, every morning, I swear, I can still remember the sound, he would turn it on and go, and we'd shake it. So it would go, razor, 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 razor. And I always thought this was like the stupidest thing. You're waiting for this to see what it's going to look like when I do that hand motion, but it's going to be awesome. But he would do that every morning, and this was it. It was to throw the big beans, throw them in a circle. And This is
so you get more of an even grind.
Right.
Well, I just add a few seconds to the preset grind for drip grind, and that helps a lot. But
it also kind of makes like coffee dust.
Well, it does that too. Yeah. Then I rely on the filter too. You know, but it's only a few seconds. You know, I count. I literally, you know, dot dot dot, and then boom, I'm done. So we Ian
One
Zook said hello to you. Hello to Ian.
Hello,
Zook.
Hello, Ian. Glad you found us.
Ian Zook is a friend of the shop. Ian is Ian.
I drove by your school actually on my way up here.
That's right, up Interstate 81.
That's right.
How was the drive?
Actually, it was really nice. It was really nice.
Better than 95, I bet.
I've only driven 95 a few times, but it was nice. Gorgeous.
Great.
Beautiful.
Great.
Beautiful.
So. We don't really have a set script here. We're going to talk about coffee. We're going to talk about horn manufacture and design. But we did have a question come through. You guys at thebrassbench.com, YOUGUIS, at thebrassbench.com. It's like a station identification. But Jeffrey Cook asked you a question. You know Jeffrey, right?
Yeah, we've met before. So what was his question?
Jeffrey said, regarding horn design... Do you see any uncommon or unique designs that work for your sensibilities as a designer? Follow-up question. Also, is there a way to create the elements of a Schmidt wrap without the piston valve? Two questions, really.
Okay, so, I mean, obviously...
Unique designs that work for your sensibilities as a designer.
I mean, that's a good question. I mean, so if you you've seen the pictorial history book, yeah?
The
one that starts with a K.
Right there. The Kulturische. Sorry.
Yeah, I'm not
German
even,
watchers.
I'm not even gonna. I'm not even trying.
Is horrible. I have it. Yeah. I haven't looked at the whole book, but.
Okay. Well, if you look at the book, it's full of innovative designs that are no longer around. So, I mean, you know, you have to make a decision, you know, is it compelling because it's innovative or is it compelling because it works and people like it and it works in them?
Well, you know, there are, now correct me if I am wrong, and I often am, and you often do, but there are three basic wraps of a horn that we see in manufacture today for double horns. You see, you see the standard Kruspa wrap as you see in the Con 8D and the Yamaha 668.
That's right.
Then there's the Geyer or sometimes Knopf wrap that you see in your horns, Yamaha 667, and now the new Yamaha 671, 871 series, I believe. And then you see in double horns, you see a Schmidt, a CF Schmidt style piston valve horn. I mean, these are the three major types, but there are variations, right?
Well, I mean, don't forget the Alexander, because you'll have lots of...
Oh, the 103.
Yeah, you'll have a lot of angry emails after this if you don't mention
Europe
that
will be all over my butt. Yes, you're right. Four major wraps.
There's probably more if we think really hard.
Well, I'm talking about in large production. Yes, in large production.
That most people would recognize just...
looking at it.
Just looking at them.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, and you know, everybody knows what an Alphorn looks like.
Yes.
Right? So, you know, when what is a design of a horn really supposed to do? Well, it's really supposed to cram the length of an Alphorn into something that you can, you know, fit in a case, take on an airplane, or, and this is just happens to be one particular shape. I mean, so, you know, you could take a view that, you know, literally, if you can get the tubes from point A to point B, mm-hmm. that's your design.
Right. I was gonna say that, yeah. that there is the thinking that it's the taper and not the wrap.
Right. I mean, and so...
well, not merely the taper, but basically the taper is important. There are other... I mean, practically every variable is important, but are there distinctions? Like if you have a Geyer wrap, a Knopf wrap, a Jacob Medlin Geyer, somebody else's Geyer, I mean, what are the... are there, you know, variations that really are important?
Well, I mean, I would say, first of all, that you know, when you're talking about... when you're talking about horn design, you're really mm-hmm. talking more about evolution.
Okay.
Because, I mean, these are not like... none of them are designs that were created in the last 100 years.
Yeah.
Would that be fair to say?
Yeah. Fair to say.
And there have been some that have come along in that time.
Mm-hmm.
And they have sort of come and gone, and they have
yes.
never really, you know...
Yes.
And that book is full of them.
Okay.
Any good pictorial history book is going to contain pages this thick of just different omnitonic horn variations,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, when you're talking about the design of a horn, really what you're saying is, okay, you know, these are the ones that have made it through the grinder, so to speak. Because there have been other ones, like I said, they've come, they've gone.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, what are the components that go into sort of these designs? And I think that's sort of what Jeff is asking is, you know, okay, so for my sensibilities, mm-hmm. what are my sensibilities?
Mm-hmm.
My sensibilities are very simple. You know, the horn is a complete resonating body. It's either all on or it's all off. So I look for design elements that...
it's binary.
That
on yeah, or off.
On or off.
Okay.
So I look for design elements that are going to take all of the individual components of the horn
mm-hmm.
and compact them into a single instrument rather than having things sort of on or off or things like that.
Okay.
So, for example, he specifically is bringing up the piston wrap, the C.F. Schmidt.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, one thing that people often come up with is they always sort of make the assumption that the C.F. Schmidt horns play the way they do because of the piston.
Right.
And, you know, pistons are very different. They're different in the way that they divert airflow than
right.
than rotors. Obviously, no one can argue that. But
right.
I think to sort of break that design down and pick out that one element is the difference
mm-hmm.
sort of minimizes all of the other design elements of that horn that are different.
Right.
You know, for example, why do people continue to go back to that design? And I think it's because that design plays in a particular way. People
mm-hmm.
people really find the note connections between the notes as you slur through the notes. All of the notes, you know, sometimes you play a horn and every time you push a valve, the horn sort of jumps over that valve.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I'm going to jump in here. Ian has a question.
Oh, Ian has a question.
Yeah, we're going to, we'll come back to what you're saying.
Yeah.
Ian said, do you think the ascending valve system is still viable in modern horn design? I know you have an opinion on it.
Thank you for that softball, Ian.
Eddie throws him a hanging curveball.
Yeah. Wow, left it hanging there. Thanks.
Yeah, go for that, and then we'll get back to Jeffrey's.
Okay, so, you know, the ascending valve. So you may be interested to know that I spend a lot of time making fingering charts of what happens if you have a key that adds this much tubing or takes away this much tubing or whatever. So
a lot of time? This isn't a major part of your day.
Enough. Yeah, enough.
Okay, so you make fingering charts.
So, one of the things I have been really, really surprised at is how little use the third valve gets.
Right.
The actual descending third valve.
Right.
When you start to think about it, you know, there are so many combinations on the horn that involve the third valve that are terrible.
I mean, yes.
When was the last time anybody said, no, 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 you should use 1 and 3 there? You know, oh, you should use 1, 2, and 3 for that note. Like, nobody ever gives that advice. In fact, people have all sorts of alternate fingers to get away from using third valve.
Yes.
And really, you know, it's there to fill in a couple of specific notes.
Yeah, I think it's like 2, right? On a standard range, tessitura range of a double horn?
Well, if you take out the numbers of people who use them in alternate fingering scenarios.
I mean, absolutely must have notes.
Yeah, right.
Or the notes won't play.
So, for example, A flat below the staff is one. There's others, but you know, I've got them all.
C sharp.
Them all in my fingering chart.
Yeah. Okay. They're all Jacob's fingering chart.
They're all on my fingering chart. So, you really actually may not.
Here, we're gonna move this.
All right. So move the grinder.
Yeah. We're gonna bring your horn more into view.
Okay. So you know, really, you could make a pretty compelling case that, you know, if you could find some other way of getting just a couple of those notes, that you wouldn't actually want to have them. The descending slides, anyway.
Right.
Okay, so what would you put there instead? Well, okay, so if you put an ascending whole step on the third valve, like Ian would like, if you do that, you get all sorts of awesome stuff. So, for example, one of the things that happens is, you know, the horn. So every time you add a finger, the horn gets sharper because you can't add, you cannot add vowels in the proper ratio for every place in the horn, right?
Right.
Okay. So basically, what ends up happening is if you've got an F horn, for example, and all of your fingerings go farther and farther below an F horn. Right. By the time you get to those bottom fingerings, you're flatter and flatter and flatter away from the F horn.
Right.
Right?
Right.
So if you put an ascending valve on there, then basically the F horn is now really a true middle spot. You have a couple of half steps below and then a couple above. So you're staying sort of more true around what that horn's natural key is gonna be, which is F or B flat.
Okay.
If you have a C valve.
Okay.
So you got all sorts of awesome, cool fingering combinations. You also get an ascending half step with the 2 and 3 combination. And actually, it's sort of surprising that this isn't more of a popular idea because, you know, at one time when most people were playing single F horns, what would distinguish a high horn from a low horn was whether or not it had an ascending or a descending third valve.
Right.
And actually, you know, Rick has a, my teacher Rick Serafinov has a piston horn with piston valves with a removable slide, a removable crook, and a removable piston to make it descending or ascending. So you have to take the piston out and replace it with a different piston.
Now
it
makes sense. Okay.
That's
kind of cool.
This was done. This was a common thing.
So
why is it going away? I can't answer that. I don't know. But it's coming back for you, Ian.
There you go. I mean, what about pedagogy? I mean, do you think? I mean, we all learn the same fingerings. We all learn, you know, the harmonic series.
Okay.
And the fact that we're adding tubing in order to lower the pitch.
Right.
And so all of the valves lower the pitch a certain amount.
Mm-hmm. So here's the creepy thing.
Yes.
Not creepy like creepy, but creepy as in really cool.
Yeah.
If you hand somebody a horn with an ascending third valve,
right,
instead of a descending third valve,
right,
and you just say, here, play this horn, they will almost certainly not notice until they get to a very, very certain... So there's only a couple of weird notes, like the A flat in the middle of the staff now becomes on the F side. So most people have their break between the F and the B flat sides. If it's not C, of course, there's all sorts of people that want it to be, you know, C and above and C and below. But for people that do it at the A flat, the different...
Just don't use the thumb? Just
yeah, so basically, you know, most people that I know anyway, G is on the F side. A flat is on the B flat side, right? And then you can keep going up. On a descending horn, you just move it up.
On a standard double horn.
Right, on an ascending horn, you just move that up one. So A flat is now on the F side. But it's actually an awesome note because rather than being like, you know, way, way, way down here, it's it's actually just a half step below the G. So it feels like playing a G, no problem. And then you
I like
go
that.
Up from there.
I like that.
So most of the time, most people don't notice the fingering problems.
That's cool.
The 2 and 3 combinations still do the same thing. It's just, you know, rather than it's like stopped horn.
Okay.
So here's a crazy thing about stopped horn. Depending on how you look at it, you can either say that when you fully close and stop the horn, it pops up, right, to the next highest. Probably lots of people know this argument. So either, you know, let's say you're playing a, so it goes up a half step, or it goes all the way down.
Right.
And it just so happens that that's a half step above the next lowest partial.
Right.
So which direction are you coming from?
It's an A flat pedal as well.
Well, who needs that? Really?
Ian does.
Well, I know. So...
stopping valve question mark.
Yes.
I guess that's what we were just talking about.
My vision for the ascending valve, is not that it's going to be a horn that could cover literally everything for a million years all the time. I personally am willing to give up an A-flat pedal.
I never ruined my life.
I mean, you know, B-flat pedal for me is pretty much... you know, I know that there are use.
Where does one use A flat pedal? You're familiar with the literature.
I believe that there is an excerpt. I believe it's a Mahler excerpt that you need a pedal A flat.
Oh, damn Mahler.
But don't quote me on that, Ian. Actually, Ian, if you won't mind. Yeah. Ian, help us out.
Help us out. Where does one need an A flat pedal? Where in the literature?
He'll type it in.
I'm sure.
Sure.
Well, there's latency, so he probably won't hear this for a few seconds. So.
Oh.
By the way, I'll say again, if anybody has any trouble, you know, with audio, video, whatever, just type in the chat, let us know, and we'll do our best to fix it. But I think we pretty much have a lot of the kinks from last week worked out. So are we done? Are there some more about the ascending horn that you want to?
It's awesome.
It's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, what?
Get yours today.
No, I mean, I don't know.
You can. There are out there. I mean, Selmer had a series.
Yes.
With ascending.
Yes.
Third.
And I don't know a way to say this. That's not like, I have a folder on my computer devoted entirely to pictures of this one particular.
You're not going to get raided by the FBI.
This one particular model of ascending Selmer, horn.
Okay.
There was both an ascending and descending version. I think that the ascending one is awesomer.
So here we go. Ian told us you and Franz Strauss Nocturne must not have dated much.
Actually, that's very true. That's very true. I tend to avoid that one if I can. Yeah. Huh. So how would I do that? Well, I mean, okay. So a lot of times people who play
just sing it.
Well, so a lot of times, and this
reminds
me
of a story.
This was true for. I mean, so we started with two valves. We may have even started with one. I don't know. But there was a point in the horn history where horn technique was a combination of valves and hand stopping.
Yes.
So a lot of people who
We're there now. I mean, obviously. That's still a point in horn history.
Well, I mean, they would actually, you know, the valves would cover a certain set of pitches.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
And you would fill them in. You would fill in half steps
with
the half.
It's all about the hands, right.
So, you know, the valves would basically cover things that, you know, anybody who's played a lot of hand horn knows there's certain notes that, like, you have to completely hand stop and then, like, throw it open and really try to you know, get the pitch right. all the way down to the right.
All the way down.
So I know people that play, for example, single B flat horns.
Mm-hmm.
There are certain notes that you can't, like certain pedal notes, and they will like the low B flat on a three valve single B flat mm-hmm. is non-existent. So right. a lot of times people will play that 1, 2, and 3
mm-hmm.
cover, and they can get it. So theoretically, it would be possible, and I don't know because I have not played obviously Strauss Nocturne as much as Ian has, but
well, there's a simple solution. Don't play it.
yes.
Which was the solution. That's the road you've taken all these years.
Well, yeah. There's lots of things I've taken that.
Yeah, solution. A lot of roads.
So, but you could.
We have a question over here. I think.
I have a question for you, Jacob. In the horn manufacturing process, not to derail the conversation too much, what is the most difficult or nerve-wracking part of the entire thing?
Well, that's a question from our director, Adam.
Well, those are different questions. Because I would say the most nerve-wracking part is, I just finished this for you.
Yeah.
And the most difficult part is probably all the stuff. That stuff.
The horn itself is the most difficult part. The nerve-wracking part is acceptance of the horn, right?
Yeah.
By the way, Ian says that he loves the ascending system and he wants you to be a pioneer in this. He wants you to bring it back.
Well, everybody loves pioneers, but
they've got the arrows in their backs, right?
That's right.
Ian, if you want to invest in a new venture for Medlin Horns,
well, we'll see what he does. Ian's got some stuff coming up, so we'll see if he uses his good stuff. Yeah, we'll see if he uses his spot for an ascending horn. I think he will. I think he should. So difficult stuff. I would say. A lot of the parts fitting is the really difficult stuff.
Right.
I mean, you can build a horn actually pretty easily. I mean,
mm-hmm.
there's nothing preventing anyone from building a horn. It just takes some tubing and it takes some rod and it takes some parts.
Sure.
And
easiest thing in the world.
Well, I mean, sure. Yeah. It's not the challenge. The tricky part is you have to commit to a philosophy.
Well, that's what Jeffrey's question was.
Yeah, you got to commit to a sort of right. of an element, and then you mm-hmm. got to make sure that the parts and stuff.
By the way, we are getting back to that second question, Jeffrey.
Go ahead
about the piston.
Mm-hmm.
About the
Schmidt.
I'm just along for the ride, Dave. You.
No, I. But you have to commit to a philosophy.
Yeah, you do. And one of those philosophies for me is this whole idea of stress relief. Question. And you find this a lot. You find a lot of manufacturers and people who mm-hmm. will say, oh, well, you know, we build things without stress relief. But
mm-hmm.
there's actually, there are two very different elements to stress relieving parts. And one of them is the making of the part.
Mm-hmm.
And the second of it is the installing of the part, the building the part into the
right,
horn.
Right.
You know, every brass is not.
So this is every part you're talking.
This is every single
part. Every single part of the horn.
You know, a lot of people, actually, a lot of people always encourage me. Oh, you should get some help. You should mm-hmm. you should hire a bunch of people and make them faster.
Oh yeah.
And I think about this a lot. I struggle with this question of okay, which parts of this horn do I feel like, you know, I can make compromises on or I could have subbed out and brought in or things like that.
Well, you do sub parts out.
There are parts that I sub out, yes.
Right.
Yes.
The machines, as we like to call them, the actual rotating valves.
The rotating valves, yes. I have not the knowledge or capacity to make those or build those. And quite frankly, I find them a little bit boring because they're the same every time, which is good. But
well,
not
yeah, that's good. Yeah. Okay.
It's not.
Exactly is the difference between a rotating valve and the normal valve system?
Well, most brass players will know this, but
like the
I don't know this.
Yeah, our director Adam doesn't know this because he's a string player. He's a bass player.
So the valves in the book that mm-hmm. we were discussing earlier, there are tons and tons and tons of different
mm-hmm.
valves that have been tried.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
there's the Vienna horn, the Pumpen valve.
There is the Vienna horn.
another major thing.
There's the Stolzel valve.
The Stolzel valve, yeah.
Which I actually really like the Stolzel valve because it's essentially, component-wise, the same as the horn. It's all sort of tube and spring and things like that.
Right.
So you can, you know, if you're somebody who's capable of processing and making things with tube, you can make a Stolzel valve.
Right.
Which I think is super cool. Actually, you could probably make a piston valve too. A lot of those, but then you need the reamers and the thingies that go into the ports.
What, the balling it out of the. Well, piston valves are just a completely different manufacturing process, and they involve different kinds of tolerances and different kinds of machinery to make. I mean, they involve honing machines.
Mm-hmm.
They're cylindrical, obviously, because they have to. They have a different way to move the sound wave from one channel to another.
That actually brings up an interesting point because
the Schmidt.
Well, yeah. So you know, a lot of people point to the pistons, mm-hmm. and actually, I've seen people make piston horns in various, you know, like three valve piston,
right?
Piston instruments, trying to capture what
piston double horns though.
I don't think I've seen a piston double horn.
That would have to have a compensating type. I mean, it would have to be a compensating.
It probably would. I got enough to think about that.
Okay.
I don't want to. I'm not kidding. Actually, I don't particularly like piston valves of any kind, but they're just trouble.
They're
just trouble.
I find rotary valves to be a more mechanically sound thing to deal with.
There's an awesome thing about rotary valves that I think I know is different with pistons, but you'll have to tell me if I'm wrong about this.
Which is
this goes to the point about why sometimes you see these turned around this way. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they're all in the same direction. Sometimes mm-hmm. one of them is in a different will rotate in a different. So you know,
right?
Because as the port opens, mm-hmm. right? The port opens and it actually allows air before that is entirely open. It allows air to leak around it into the surrounding tubes.
Right.
So you never get that pop back in your face,
right.
of the air coming to a complete stop.
Right.
Except for when the rotors are through hole rotors.
Yeah.
Sometimes those rotors, if they have a hole drilled in them rather than having the windway cut this way, you will actually get that seal halfway through.
I had a customer a couple weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
Sent me an email and said, I'm having a problem. I just bought this horn, and when I change sides of the horn,
mm-hmm.
I use a change valve, I feel a hesitation. I feel the pressure back in my face.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, I don't know. It could be a lot of things, but my guess is that your change valve is, in fact, a through port and not a cut channel. And the difference is probably escapes a lot of people, since a lot of players have never even seen the rotors inside their horn. But a cut channel literally has a channel cut like a C through it. And a through port is like a piston. The wall of the rotor is actually complete all the way through, and it's got a hole, a tube in the rotor.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, when she brought it in, yeah, it was a through port. It was not a cut channel.
Excellent diagnosis, Dave.
Well, you know. That's why they pay me
the big bucks.
The great big old bucks.
As they say.
So anyway, back to your sensibilities. What are your sensibilities? You like rotary valves, obviously.
I love rotary valves.
Mm-hmm.
I think they are gorgeous feet of old and new manufacturing styles. Actually,
what about string linkage versus mechanical linkage? Do you have an opinion on that? Just a side note.
So I have seen the diagrams that people make, and I'm actually convinced mm-hmm. by them,
mm-hmm.
showing how the when you have a mechanical linkage, when you push that mechanical linkage, it just slightly tilts the rotor.
Mm-hmm.
And so over time, yeah, you probably could get a little bit of extra end play,
mm-hmm.
possibly.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen those diagrams, I've seen those things, and sure, I think I can get on board with that.
Meaning, get on board with mechanical linkages?
No, get on board with the idea that a string linkage has a more uniform sort of twist to the operation rather than pushing it.
A mechanical linkage is physically attached where the string is held down by the screw. I don't know if we can see that, but you know, this is the string screw here. Mm-hmm. Where the string is held by the screw is essentially where you would have a mechanical linkage affixed.
Right.
And the only time that you have, I think it's angular momentum. I forget which forces in play here.
Some physics thing.
Yes, some darn physics thing. So the only time where you have the least amount of force required to keep moving that valve is when it is exactly
in the middle.
In the middle.
Yep.
Otherwise, you have to push harder or pull harder. Mm-hmm. So it's not a uniform force required. Now, is it a force that you're going to notice is a question.
I don't know. The other thing I have noticed about mechanical...
If your string breaks, you're going to notice.
This is true. This is true. And actually, you know, I think about that a lot when I have this sort of favorite kind of job to do, which is like in the pit. You know, with, I love pit work.
Oh, okay.
And I often think about, you know, what is the most awesome, coolest idea for my own personal, like if I'm going to design a horn for myself,
mm-hmm.
what is the coolest idea I can come up with
mm-hmm.
to get, you know, what I want?
Mm-hmm.
And I go back and forth. I go back and forth on this question.
Okay.
Knowing what I know about mechanical linkage.
Right.
Given the fact that, you know, pit work is so long,
mm-hmm.
you don't have those opportunities to necessarily, you know, put out fires.
Mm-hmm.
Would I pick mechanical? And I might.
Mm-hmm.
I might.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. The other thing I have noticed about mechanical linkages is the throw tends to be longer. And I've tried to figure out if I can see why that would be. But
well, I have an opinion on that.
Sure.
Okay. So, because there was a question on the Horn People group the other day
mm-hmm.
about, somebody was asking if their horn could be converted to mechanical linkage to reduce the throw. And reduce the throw. And yes, you can, of course. You can mm-hmm. do practically anything you want to do, but you don't get something for nothing. Now, the throw of the valve is proportional to the... It's a fulcrum. It's like a seesaw.
Your mechanical advantage.
It's like a seesaw. And if the shorter throw is when you have your fingers go closer to the fulcrum in order to do the same amount of work on the other end.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the long and vice versa. So on the other end, the way you shorten it up is you can get the lever closer, you can move it closer to the center of rotation. So if you could cut that circle that the string goes around
mm-hmm.
down to like half the circumference, it would be half the throw. You'd have to move it through half the distance.
But the forces
would be enormous.
Yeah.
You wouldn't be able to push it. That's the problem. Now the mechanical linkage is just the opposite, because you're coming away from the stop armature
mm-hmm.
out to the screw.
Yeah.
Out to where that screw is. So you're moving away from the center out to that screw, and you're making it a longer lever on this side, but you're not changing the other side of the seesaw.
Well, one of the
and
things,
so you have to throw it further.
So I had Meinelschmidt actually
mm-hmm.
sort of change. Normally this is on the top, and the rod is on the top of this.
Oh yeah,
here.
they're underbuilt.
And
yeah.
I put it underneath.
Yeah, I didn't notice that.
Basically, to try to get a tiny little bit of extra. I mean, it's very, very small.
Right.
But you can tell.
Right. Well, and the thing with the articulated linkages is that you keep that lever moving in the same plane as the string. That's the idea.
Except
and what you've done is when you with building that underneath like that,
mm-hmm.
you get a little closer to that.
Well, you can lengthen the actual key. You can uh-huh. make it longer mm-hmm. so that, you know, less effort takes you farther towards the valve.
Right.
But
is this only on your valves from Meinelschmidt, or do other?
I don't know. Okay. I don't know.
They're on yours at least.
They're on mine. Okay. I do
another design philosophy. I never thought about that. But yeah, it's.
I don't know. I send an email to Anna. I say hi, Anna.
Anna.
I'd like my usual, please. And they show up. And I send them, you know, requests now and then, and they're more than happy to work with them.
Very good.
But so, So, okay, so long joints and mm-hmm. C.F. Schmidt horns.
Yes, let's get to that.
When I look at a C.F. Schmidt mm-hmm. horn, what I notice is that almost all of the joints are long joints. I think you call these draw joints.
Draw joints.
Draw joints.
I call it, yes, they're solder draws. They're not actual physical braces.
Right. Yes. Yeah. So whatever you call them, I just call them long.
Well, there's not joints. An extra part. There's just solder and tube.
Solder and tube.
There's no brace rod, no brace. Solder and tube.
Solder and tube. Yeah, so there's no...
Something from the Industrial Revolution.
So here's the weird thing. Uh-huh. You know, people talk about taking away braces to save weight.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, okay, so, you know, on this lower portion of the F branch,
right?
If I weigh out the amount of solder that I used in here,
mm-hmm.
it's less than one brace. So I would have to, you know, if I put two braces here,
mm-hmm.
you know, it would double the weight. And I don't really understand the whole weight thing that people get nuts about anyway. I think it's, you know, people sometimes lose sight of other design things when they go okay. for weight.
But you're saying it's not purely about weight.
No, it's not purely about weight. It's about making these two tubes
mm-hmm.
vibrate together
mm-hmm.
so that when this tube vibrates, this tube sort of vibrates.
Mm-hmm.
So what I like about the Schmidt model mm-hmm. horns is that, you know, all of those solder joints together
mm-hmm.
makes the horns, I don't know, I refer to this in my own diagram, my drawings and everything as density,
mm-hmm.
just because it seems like it's a better description than
that's
weight.
That's the visual image you have in your mind.
Yeah, density doesn't necessarily imply heavy,
mm-hmm.
right? It's a.
Well, I don't know if it implies it, but it's certainly the image you get. More dense, more heavy.
Well, no, I want to disassociate that.
Right. I understand.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. So you know, actually, I've been surprised. A lot of times, people will comment on the physical lightness of the horns.
Mm-hmm.
Which is not intentional. I mean, it is what it is. Fine, but
we're getting to your questions, everybody.
The long joints, to me, that's what gives those Schmidt horns the qualities that people like about them, which mm-hmm. is the smoothness, the sort of really really complex colors.
Right.
I find that as I move more and more to these longer and longer joints,
mm-hmm.
those are what I get.
Those are what you get. Yeah.
Those are what I get.
Now, Ian asked. That the Schmidt, points out that the Schmidt has a more oblong shaped lead pipe, and he's asking, does that make a considerable difference?
Yes and no. I would say no in the fact that the oblong shape has a design qualification to it,
mm-hmm.
but yes in that those Schmidt horns, if you notice, not only are they oblong, but they follow the curve of the bell, like sometimes almost all the way down
right.
before coming up, and right. usually that joint from top to bottom is completely
soldered. Right. No bracing.
Single draw.
Right. And that's how you fix your lead pipe in that area, right? You solder
yes.
along
yes.
that line.
I like to come off of the horn just a little bit. I like the joint to be about the width of the hand.
Mm-hmm.
It's because I feel like if you leave these sort of unbraced, depending on how big your hand is
mm-hmm.
or how hard you squeeze, you're actually changing the way that horn is vibrating.
People when they play, they talk about what notes they feel vibrating under their hand.
Yes. Yeah.
And is that a consideration as well?
Yeah, my personal preference is that none of them do. None of them vibrate more than any of the other ones.
So you like even
yeah.
response
yeah.
throughout.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. And that's really, really hard to do.
Mm-hmm.
Really, really, really hard to do. But it has to do with the fact that certain notes, and this is actually, this is my most recent line of investigation. I've been going back to some of the nodal research that people mm-hmm. had been doing in the mm-hmm. 60s and 70s. And a lot of times they do those in relationship with, you know, taper
mm-hmm.
design.
Mm-hmm.
But there's also a really interesting thing, which is, if you feel a horn vibrating
mm-hmm.
in your hand
mm-hmm.
and you trace the high pressure points of that node throughout the horn, more than likely you'll find a high pressure point in a hang-off brace or a brace that has a long section which is not attached to the horn anywhere.
Interesting.
Because that length of tube, when it hits that high pressure point right in the middle, you know, starts to really, really vibrate. And then if you've done it correctly and everything is attached and all the parts work together, the whole horn should vibrate.
Yeah, we're going to get to Vincent's question. Vincent asked, how do you get into horn repair and manufacturing? Music major, I assume he means he's a music major, always had an interest in repair work. So so let's get a little bit away from horn design and manufacture to your history and my history. Let's talk about that.
Okay.
Let's hear about you're the guest. Vincent's going to have me. He's going to hear me several times.
Ad nauseum. About it,
but how did Jacob Medlin go from little Jacob playing soccer at home to making, like, I mean, look, they're really fantastic ones. So
thanks,
how do
Dave.
You
very nice of you to say.
Well, it's true, but go ahead. How do you get from A to B?
Okay, so Vincent, to answer your question, I actually can't tell you. I have no idea.
You don't know how you got here?
I know how I got here, but people ask me this a lot.
Or there's no formula is what you're saying.
People ask me all the time, I'm really interested in this. How do I do it?
Right. I get that all the time,
we have these philosophical questions every now and then.
Every now and then.
And I have this particular one with people a lot of times. If you could go back 10 years and be 10 years younger, would you do it? And when I think about that question, I don't think I would. And the reason is, I don't think I could willfully construct the events leading up to this.
Happenstance.
Yeah, I don't think I could.
Fate guided you to where you are today?
So I have to say, there are a couple of elements for me personally. And
okay.
And I hope this is, bravo for thinking outside the box, because, you know, we all know that the music business is tough.
Every aspect of it.
It's all tough. There are a couple of elements that were really important for me, but we'll get to those, I guess.
Go ahead.
I was a graduate student at IU.
IU. Indiana University.
Indiana University.
Studying with Rick Serafinoff.
No.
No.
No. I was in Jeff Nelson's studio.
Okay.
Shout out to Jeff. Who, by the way.
Hey, Jeff.
Jeff, this is all thanks to being fearless. So, put that on your
resume. Fearless performance,
no,
folks.
No.
Jeff.
Fearless. Everything else.
Fearless. Just being fearless.
Just fearless.
Just fearless. You Jeff know. Taught you to be fearless,
Jeff,
or he brought it out?
Jeff, I tell this story also to people. When I first got to IU, my lessons with Jeff
right.
basically were about 3 minutes of playing and then 57 minutes of me trying to get a sentence out in the proper order that had no negatives connotations in them and that were 100% completely positive and constructive. And this went on for months and months and months.
Okay.
And I have to say,
were you fearless at that point?
I was not.
Not. You were fearful.
I was not. And it was more about making everything into positive, always being positive moving forward,
right.
being progressive, being constructive,
right.
and not being hung up on those other things.
Right.
I also have this thing about, you know, the line between fearless and reckless being, you know, razor thin. Walking that line is important to me. But so I went to study with Jeff.
Yeah, right.
The events that brought me to Jeff's doorstep were ridiculous.
Well, I don't think we need to go over those.
I don't think so. They're not applicable to the story.
We want to know how you get from Jeff to...
So when I got to IU,
right,
I was, just like every other horn player, going to be the principal horn of the Chicago Symphony.
Were you?
Yeah,
awesome.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I went to IU to learn how to be the principal horn of the Chicago Symphony.
Not San Francisco.
Oh, absolutely.
Or San Francisco.
Oh, of course. San Francisco. Okay. I was going to be the principal horn of everything simultaneously. Right? That is to say, I was there to study horn.
Exactly. Horn performance. Yeah.
And
Vincent says he's a master's in performance, so he's right there with you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. So I was right there. And I went to IU. My first day at IU, I had a meeting with my graduate advisor, who happened to be Rick Serafinov.
Oh, he was your graduate advisor.
He was my graduate advisor. Right, right. And I knew about him because, you know, history of like tinkering and blah blah blah. I mean, I was your ubiquitous, you know, annoying kid that had his hands all over everything to take it apart. And I had a box in my garage where my parents would put their old broken stuff that I could, you know, take apart and mess around with.
Right, right.
So, you know, this is not like a just out of the blue.
No, you had that propensity.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, and Cromer and I have talked about this a million times. I mean,
yeah.
he did like model railroading.
I mean,
tinkering like crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So but it's the fine motor, you know, all of that. So
right.
Anyway, I had done it. So I was primed for it, I suppose.
Okay.
You might
the
say.
Pump was primed. The
pump was primed. And I knew about Rick, and I said, I know you make horns. I love horns.
Mm-hmm.
I love making stuff. Can I come to your shop? And he said, sure. And he took out a piece of paper, and he wrote an address down, and he said, here it is. I'll be home by about 6 o'clock. If you're there by 6:30, you know, you should be fine.
Oh, okay, okay. I thought I was going to say, if you were there by 6:30, I don't want to see your face ever again.
Well, in other words, it was like, yeah, here it is. I'll see you tonight.
That's right.
And, you know, when I think about this story, like when I really, really reflect and I ask myself, like, why did I go?
Right.
I have no answer. But for some reason, I left, I got in my car, and I drove 45 minutes because Rick lives like way out there.
He's not living in Bloomington proper.
So whenever I call Rick sometimes, the call always gets dropped every time. And I'll call him back and
that's
say,
how far he is out there.
And I'll call him back and I'll say, well, you just drove up the hill and you're by the mailbox at the bottom of the hill, aren't you? And he's like, yep. I mean, so literally there's like cell coverage from like four different towers.
Signal
that,
shadow, right.
Oh my gosh. So he lives way out there. But anyway, I did it.
Mm-hmm.
For some reason, I did it. I was out there. And for a long time, again, when I reflect on this story, I cannot say why I continue to do this because it made absolutely no sense. But I went and I sat on his bench at night while he worked and just listened to him tell stories and talk about what he was doing.
Right.
And, you know, we would listen to the radio. This is when I learned that a complete Haydn cycle recording, literally, if you put one of those on, you can work for a week straight and not even notice the time has passed. It's like ridiculous. It's amazing.
Okay.
It's amazing.
Cool.
And of course, Rick has an amazing wine cellar. So,
what?
So, oh man, oh. It's
doesn't hurt.
Well, so yeah, and he would.
Stuff.
You have no idea. You have no idea.
The definition of the good stuff.
I have all sorts of fun, awesome wine stories that we don't need to tell here.
No,
but
we don't have that much time. So,
here, Jacob, I have a question, two-parter question for you.
Well, he's not finished with his story.
Oh, okay.
Let me we're still not at. He's making these great horns.
I'm not making horns yet. Yes. I'm literally sitting. I mean, and I had a part-time job.
Mm-hmm.
Like a 20-hour week job at the music library.
Right.
As a cataloger.
Nice.
Which was another, like, down in the basement, like, away from them.
I'm starting to sense a pattern here.
So,
being away from people, by oneself.
Actually, that was an awesome job. That was an awesome job.
Have you ever seen Idiocracy?
Yes, I have. Yes, I have.
You're Luke Wilson.
And it's not because I've seen it. It's because I've heard you describe it to me so many times. And I feel like I've seen
so
it.
So you're Luke Wilson in Idiocracy?
Possibly. So
sitting in the stacks all by yourself.
So I did this for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks.
Uh-huh.
And this is like the greatest and worst thing that has ever happened in Rick's shop, in my opinion, is he was coppersmithing a copper bowl one weekend.
Okay.
He went way overboard and he wrecked his arm.
Oh.
Which was...
Fate does have a hand in the story.
It was horribly painful and has taken him a long time. And actually, it still affects... He does a lot of his techniques a little differently now, just to preserve his arm.
We're not
as long
sharing secrets we shouldn't be sharing, are we? Well, it's already
out. No. I'm not going to say what his techniques are, because clearly they're...
No, but I mean, the fact that he's changed his techniques. But he hurt himself.
So he hurt his arm, and he looked at me one day, and he was like, well, if you're gonna be, so, if you're gonna be taking up all this
so
space
up to that
time,
point you've just been like his shop cat or
for,
something
for months for months days just for like months. And why did I continue to go back? I have no idea.
Okay,
but I did.
Okay
I did.
Fate has a hand.
And so for the next however many months I would literally
opportunity knocked on
every
the door.
Weekend I would go to mm-hmm. his shop mm-hmm. and I would pound tube through draw plates because that was what hurt his arm the most. Mm-hmm. I would pound to and mm-hmm. tape sand bell tails. Mm-hmm. That was the other thing I did.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I did that forever. Probably another 3 or 4 months.
Right.
And then he said the school needs the natural horns rebuilt. Would you like to do it?
Mm-hmm.
I said, great.
Mm-hmm.
So one by one, I rebuilt the natural horns for IU.
Right.
And then he said, okay, well, why don't you build one from an actual bell.
Mm-hmm.
Here's one. So I did that. You know, so basically this is Rick basically, you know, giving me more and more things to do.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started to get interested in it. Not to say I wasn't interested before, but I started seeking out, we'll make some more coffee, Dave.
Jacob took my hint.
So then, you know, I was taking care of his cat. I had a key to his shop. One by one, I would learn the machinery. I did all these other things. So then I built my first double horn.
Okay.
And then I started to try to sell some stuff and try mm-hmm. to buy some parts. Anyway, that was all great, but I was still at IU. I was studying horn, and one night it was kind of late, and we were working, and Rick looked at me and he said, I really think you should take some time off of school. And
this is during your graduate student tenure. Your education. Your performance.
Yes, my performance master's.
Student. Right. Okay.
Performance. He said, you know, I've had a lot of people in and out of here.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I've been around, man.
I've been around.
He said,
I've been everywhere.
He said, I think I see in you the skills that are needed to make a go of this, and I think you should try it.
So he gave you a little push from
He
behind.
Did. I mean, I sort of tell people, you know, it, to me, being passionate about it isn't enough.
Mm-hmm.
You know, loving it's not enough. You have to have skills. You have to have a
right.
certain kind of personality.
Right.
You have to have a certain kind of work ethic and mm-hmm. hands. And for me, it was really important that Rick was the one who identified that and said, you know, you should do this.
That's great.
And I did.
And you did.
And I did.
I had a similar... is there more?
So there is one other element.
One other
which
element.
Which is I have to give a shout out to my lovely wife, Jennifer. Because there's another element of this that a lot of people don't consider. Which is that the amount of investment, money, and time, and effort,
mm-hmm.
and all of those, the amount of effort that it takes to really get started is unbelievably huge. And you know this.
I know this. My wife knows this as well.
And
so shout out to Susan, my wife.
And without somebody on that back end,
yeah,
to really, you know, I mean, pay the bills when the going gets tough. I mean, let's be honest.
Yeah, no, it's true. It's true.
You can't make it work. You absolutely cannot.
But that's true in a lot of music stuff. It's not just manufacture, it's not just repair. I mean, music is a tough business.
So, you know,
you often need someone to help carry you along.
As much as my wife's eyes glaze over when I tell her about paralleling slides, she really is, you know, half of this.
Well, you know, I don't know about you, but I think what people, especially my wife, enjoys is that, yeah, her eyes glaze over when I talk with you about paralleling slides. And we're like, oh, but what she enjoys is the fact that we're excited about it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
That we're like just so engaged in the mm-hmm. absolute fine details of what it is that we're doing.
There's something else.
One more thing,
Mike.
You said there's something else. What did you mean by that?
No, there's something else in creating and in crafting and in that that's not about the money. It's not about the fame and
right.
fortune. It's there's something else. I don't know what it is,
mm.
but it's you know, very, very personal.
Right.
Very,
well, you know, for me, I was doing pension actuarial work. Defined benefit pension actuarial work, which now everybody's eyes
now
are glazed over.
Now my eyes
see, his eyes, they should glaze over because not only is it boring,
uh-huh.
I mean, totally, completely boring. But it's like, it's dead. It's a totally dead industry. Not totally dead. It's yeah. It's quite moribund. And because nobody has pensions anymore, they all have 401k plans, you know, sort of thing. So my job was going away anyway. And I was I had gotten into doing repairs like on the side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it, the way I got into that was I got back into playing because I had been out of playing. I was a comebacker, and the instrument needed repair.
Yeah.
So I went to Bill Kendall, who was, you know, the best brass guy in the Baltimore area at the time. Probably still is. Even though I don't think he does it anymore. But Bill, I said, how are you going to do that? How are you going to take that dent out? It's just a dent. And I thought he would just, I thought he had like contraptions, like steampunk kind of thing, right? And he's like, I'll probably just take it out with a hand burnisher. And he pulled out a hand burnisher and he just like erased it with the burnisher. And there was just a thunderstruck moment when I just, I don't know how I'm going to do this, but I have to do this.
Well, for someone like Vincent...
For someone like Vincent...
For someone like Vincent...
Getting back to you, Vincent.
For somebody like Vincent... You know, it is so hard... It's so hard to construct a life in this. I mean, people do it. I mean, people do it all the time. They say, oh, you know, today I'm... This is what I'm doing today.
Right.
Blah, blah, blah. But if you really, really have a... something underneath there that is driving you to do these.
Right.
Just take every opportunity that comes, and you never, you know, you don't know which is the one that's going to be the important one that will break you through it.
Right. I mean,
here's the other thing.
Go ahead.
Here's the other thing.
Go for it, because I know where you're going with that.
Here's the other thing. If you want to be a craftsman, okay?
Yeah.
You have to decide today.
Yes.
I am a craftsman, and that doesn't mean that I'm a craftsman when I go into the shop and I'm writing on my website who I am a craftsman. This is not a marketing term. This is not a tagline at the end of a thing. If you want to be a craftsman, you have to start right now being a craftsman in everything, every way that you have to train your eyes to know what craftsmanship is. You have to train your hands. You have to train yourself to do something, have your eyes tell you it's wrong, and say, all right, this is like not what I want to do, but I'm going to do it over anyway. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And this is going to sound stupid, but this goes to like cutting the grass. This goes to like making your coffee. This goes to, you know, anything that you are going to take on that you are creating, that you're doing. I mean, even playing, you can have a craftsmanship approach to playing where you do the hard work,
right?
You demand perfection of yourself every day, no matter what
it
is.
It's a demand on yourself.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but it's not an external thing. It's you saying, this is, I have an idea, a model in my mind of what perfection is, and I'm going for that.
You have to always evaluate yourself based on that concept, not what it is that you see that you're going to be better than.
Right.
I'm going to be better than this person. That's too low. That's too low of a standard.
Right.
You have to say, this is the best thing I can possibly think of, and that's what I'm going to put. That's how I'm going to do that.
Right.
I think, speaking of craftsmanship, I think I should craft you up another cup of coffee.
I think that's a requirement. What do you think about Tanzania peaberry?
Tanzania. Oh, tell me about this one.
Well,
here, let's
move
that back, and let's
we're gonna move the horn back out of the way. I don't know what to do with the cord there.
How are we? It's plugged in. Water? Let's put a little bit more water in there.
More water.
This will qualify as a break, I guess.
Well,
yeah?
Everybody can go get their own coffee while we make our coffee. And anybody have any questions? Type them into the chat. And
oh, that's good. That's good.
Let's go.
Good.
Sorry.
It'll take too long.
Oh, I'm sorry.
All right, so
let's.
I have to also thank Katie Ambrose for letting me have her horn for one extra day.
There you go. I don't know if that was heard over the microphone. Jacob thanked Katie Ambrose for letting him have her horn one more day. That's Katie's horn sitting in front of us, right? That's headed to Katie.
That is.
All right.
I tell you, it's a It's a whopper.
Katie Ambrose, here comes your horn.
I have a question
for
you.
Adam had some questions.
What is your least favorite part of manufacturing a horn when you are building it? What is your least favorite part of that?
My least favorite part to do?
Yeah, what do you... Oh, I bet I know.
To do?
I bet I know.
I think you do know. The bad thing.
The bad thing.
The bad thing, as Rick used to call it.
Rick used to call it the bad thing. What is the bad thing?
The bad thing is buffing.
Buffing.
Yeah.
Oh, it's dangerous. People have no idea how dangerous the buffing lathe is.
It's really dangerous.
And
I tell you, there is nothing that will just destroy your day like spending all day making a perfect part and then having the wheel grab it out of your hands and mangle it beyond recognition. That is just like a soul-crushing event.
Yes. But see, here's where I think you have an advantage over me. Because here, you can, as much as you do not want this to happen,
mm-hmm.
you can make another part.
That's right.
Although you certainly don't want this to happen when you've got a full horn all built and assembled. But I don't necessarily have that luxury. When somebody's coming for their horn tomorrow and they are expecting to find everything in beautiful working order, if the buffing lathe grabs a part from me and flings it...
You're hosed. Here, I'll make you some.
I am totally hosed.
You could always call me and I'll make another part for you. No, I'm just kidding. I wouldn't do that. I would say, I'm sorry, Dave.
Rick did not live over on Camrose near the In-N-Out Burger.
No.
Those are good burgers, Walter.
This is wrapped up in a philosophical debate I have with myself all the time, which is that, yes, buffing is a requirement.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But I actually take my finishes all the way down to, like, jewelers... mirror finishes.
Right.
And people say to me all the time, why do you do that if the horn's just going to get tarnished again? And there's a practical reason,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
As you know, mm-hmm. the more highly finished a part is, the more resistant to initial oxidation it is.
Right.
So you do get an extra few weeks level of protection.
Right.
The other really nice thing is if you have a really, really finely buffed horn.
Buffed and polished.
Buffed and polished.
Right.
And you stick it in the ultrasonic tank,
right.
you're going to get much more of that initial shine back than if you put a poorly finished horn in. And I think that's kind of nice. But really, really it's about... It's this craftsmanship quality again. This question
again.
Well,
don't you want... When people get the horn, don't you want to go...
I want them to, like, cry a little bit. Like, I can't
this
believe...
This is mine! I can't believe it!
I think one of the things that I really believe is that are we what? Audible over the crack of the kettle? Perfect. One of the things I think people don't really understand mm-hmm. is the external craftsmanship, right? Is a reflection of the internal craftsmanship. You know, the outside stuff, that's the easy part. You know, anybody can learn to do these kinds of finishes,
right?
But it's about their will and their patience and their desire to do it.
Well, there's a certain amount of it is cleaning up when you're doing to manufacture, because I don't know if everybody's seen a horn metal that's been soldered, but it gets a rather rosy appearance.
Mm-hmm.
There are small solder bits or tiny little scrape marks left on the surface of the metal from getting solder off, and you know, it doesn't look beautiful
right.
when it's done being assembled.
That's right.
Even if it's assembled properly. Even if that horn has all the acoustic properties that you want, hitting every note beautifully and all the stress is out, blah, 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 it still looks ugly.
Yes.
But it's like a meal, like a fine meal at a gourmet restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
First taste is with the eyes. Is it not?
It is. It is. And I think there's an element, too. I really think that people's trust... with their instrument is super important.
Okay.
And that is to say, you know, if you're convinced that it doesn't play
mm-hmm.
a certain range well or a certain note well,
mm-hmm.
I don't care if it does or not. you're going to freak out a little bit every time you see that note come up on the page.
Okay.
Especially if you're playing, you know, piano and you have to play, you know, like a to do something delicate or do something important. If you don't trust the horn, the other thing that happens is pedagogically,
mm-hmm.
if you don't trust the note or a register or a range, you hold back the air. You hold back that initial fearlessness.
As Jeff describes.
Because, you know, more than likely, you're going to split that note, or something wonky might happen. So you sort of back it off, and then as soon as you back it off, wonky stuff happens anyway.
So you know, you've used the term stress-free when you discuss your horns, because you're not talking about the stresses in the horn. You're talking about stress in the performance as well.
Yeah, that's a good way to think of it. I wish I had thought of it. I actually did.
He did think of that. That was another softball.
Thanks, Dave.
Hey.
Well, you're really... I have to say, dude, too,
what?
Dave, that this soundstage that you guys built looks exactly like your shop.
You know, you cannot believe how much money we put into this soundstage to make it look exactly like my shop.
I mean, it's really remarkable. It's really remarkable.
All the way down to the dirt on the floor.
I mean, here we are in sunny Hollywood, and you'd think that we were in Baltimore.
You'd think we're in Timonium, Maryland. Yeah. That's right. You would think that. But no.
So, you know, you're right. No. Stress-free to me means that, and I look at it one way is, yes, stress-free.
Right.
Fine. But as Jeff would say, there's no such thing as a positive negative.
Does he really say that?
No, he doesn't actually say that.
Okay.
That's,
but
he says,
like, what the hell does that mean?
He says something similar to that, which is that, you know, you can't create a positive if you say don't do, like, so if you say don't be stressed, or you say don't do this, That
creates a negative. It's not creating the positive.
And it doesn't replace it automatically.
Right.
So what I like to do is I like to say that, you know, I want to return the sort of ease and the joy back to the music, because we're not doing it for the money.
Well, but speaking about, like, mechanical stresses and stresses in the metal.
Yes.
Like, you stress relieve the tubing that you draw and bend.
I stress relieve the tubing, like, molecularly as well,
right.
as the branch. I stress relieve the solder.
And that's
joints.
A heat treatment with the stress relief of the metal, right?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Go ahead.
That's a heat treatment.
You stress relieve the solder joints.
I stress relieve the solder joints.
Mm-hmm.
I stress relieve the slide legs.
Okay.
Literally, I mean, and this is another important thing. I know I'm not trying to hijack this back to craftsmanship, but...
No, hijack it all the way, wherever you need to take it.
But you know, just, you can't identify these necessarily by eye, either.
Well, that was actually my point.
Yeah.
Was that, you know, if you say to somebody, you know, I do this.
Yeah.
They're going to look at your horn and, well, except for paralleling the slides, which mm-hmm. I don't know, we'll probably get to that, because Jacob is just amazing at paralleling slides, and... You'd be shocked at how unparalleled many of the slides in your own instrument are. Horn, trumpet,
yeah,
especially trombone, tubas. But my point is that you can say, oh, this is the way the horn is. But your horn is going to look just like any other horn. You put that jeweler's finish on it, people can't see the stress relief or lack thereof.
Right. But... You know,
So A, it's important, but B, they can't see it. So C,
if you are a
prophet.
So C, if you are, you know, if you are evaluating and you're buying instruments,
uh-huh.
this is where it's your duty as a consumer
uh-huh.
to investigate the training level of your maker.
Okay.
Because you can't see this stuff. And you need to trust that it's being done properly. You know, every time you solder,
mm-hmm.
every time that you heat brass,
yes.
it moves.
I'll say.
You know this,
yes.
right?
Yes.
So you have absolutely you have two options. You can either you can solder it, you know, sideways and angularly, and oops,
I think we're fixing to pop here, honey.
Yes. So you can either build, you know, I'll say this another way because I don't really know how to describe this.
Might get a little noisy with the grinding of the beans in a few seconds.
What I tell people is that my ultimate philosophy is to leave no mark on the horn myself.
Okay.
Like the Appalachian Trail. If you ever hike the Appalachian Trail.
Yeah, pack in, pack out.
Pack in, you pack out. So that means that...
Leave nothing but your...
That every time I touch memories. The horn, every time I heat the horn, every time I do anything, by the time I consider that part done, I need to have removed all trace of my having handled it, which means stress relieving all of the joints, which means, you know, checking to make sure that everything lays the way that it did before I started soldering on it.
Okay.
The only way you can do that really is with calipers.
Yeah.
You know, you measure before you'd work, you measure after you work, and then you fix whatever the variation. Because there's always going to be variation. If you show me someone that says that they can solder and do this stuff without any variation, then I'm going to quit and go study with them. That's another level to be able to do that. Okay, hang on.
There we go. Grinding my beans. Enjoying my coffee.
We're going to do a nice medium course on this one.
Oh, look at those beans go down. They're going down. Get down there, bean.
Oh, you know what?
What?
We didn't... What? Where? What? Which? Is this the Idido? This is the Ethiopian, isn't it?
No, that was out of your thing. Yes. Believe me, at this point, I'll take whatever you brew in there. The Tanzania pea berry was for you to take home. Because I was telling you all about it.
Dave, you're a sweetheart. Thank you.
Well, no, you're welcome. Thank you for coming on the show. You're doing me a favor. He came all the way up from Greensboro, North Carolina. Considerable drive. So, Adam, I think, is going to ask us another question.
I have two questions here. First question, what is the hardest individual part on the horn to manufacture? Second question.
That's a good question.
Have you ever... What is the most common instance of having to scrap the manufacture of a horn?
The horn is of the whole or a part?
The whole.
The whole?
You mean like, I don't like this horn, I'm throwing it away?
Or, I guess, where is like...
Like...
Yeah, something...
Well, what's like, in other words, I'm making this horn...
You can refit the question to of whatever standard.
Yeah.
Whatever.
So hardest part to manufacture. What's the hardest part to manufacture? Can we exclude the valves?
I'm gonna interpret that to mean
except
that
for
I
the
manufacture.
Machines. Yes.
That
yes.
I personally.
Yes. Yes.
Manufacture.
That's what I was hoping you would do. Yeah.
The hardest part. I would break it up more in line of the hardest technique.
Okay.
I will say the hardest part. For me, is always this long branch.
The long F branch.
And the reason it's difficult for me...
this one here?
No. It's
this one.
Yeah, Jacob's going to touch.
Starting here and going
it goes
all the way around.
Okay. A lot of bends, a lot of geometry in that.
There's a ton of geometry, and it's actually not difficult.
It's hard. Can I just jump in real quick
here?
It's hard for the everybody to see, but I'm sitting here like admiring this. I'm going to reach over, but I'm going to describe before I reach over. I'm going to touch what I'm talking about. Is that the branch is going into these tuning slide stockings, the nickel silver tuning slide stockings. Jacob has them bent in such a way that they come zooming into the nickel silver slide stockings straight in. I mean, straight in.
Mm-hmm.
You don't see that on like a lot of horns. You'll see them come curving all the way and up to the part. I'm going to touch them and show you exactly which ones I'm talking about. I'm here to say that those bends are not easy things to do.
And actually, if you look at it this way too, it's the same. They come in exactly straight in both ways.
Yeah. Hold it.
Well, I'm showing you, and I mean, I don't know that you. I don't
know
that
anybody. Yeah. Rotate it so that maybe the overhead cam can see that.
Yeah. I don't know. You know.
Yeah. But yeah. I mean that. Okay, so go on with the hardest technique.
Has two points in it.
Yeah.
The first point is, you know, in my opinion, if you're working at a high level, you should be able to do whatever you want with the tubes. I mean, people give pitch. So I'm talking about the bending medium. At this point, people talk all the time about how much better.
Sarobend is a metal that you fill the tubes with something when you bend them so they don't just collapse.
Mm-hmm.
And pitch is a resin tar composite that is fairly easily bendable. And CeraBend is an alloy of metals that is harder to bend, but is bendable. And is used in a lot of industry, like aerospace industry and stuff like that.
And people say that it keeps the tubes rounder.
Well, doesn't it?
So,
I mean, I've used it for small bends, not large, hard bends.
So,
I felt that it has kept them pretty round.
Well, the thing about CeraBend, though, is that, yes, it will keep it round.
Right.
Regardless of how you've annealed the tube. So if you anneal a tube super soft, you fill it with CeraBend, it will stay round.
Right.
If you anneal...
Annealing is a heat treatment, just for those who don't know. It softens the non-ferrous metal.
Thank you, Dave, for that. If you've annealed the tube properly, though, and you fill it with pitch,
right,
it'll still stay around.
Okay. I believe that.
It'll still stay around. And the other advantage of pitch is that you can bend it by hand.
Right.
So you can actually...
But you have to work at a fairly... narrow temperature range so the pitch doesn't get too soft or too hard.
Yes, and it's within 0.2 degrees, whether or not it's right. So
0.2?
Yep, for me.
0.2 Fahrenheit.
0.2 Fahrenheit.
So don't your hands like raise the temperature?
Yes, they do.
Oh.
Yes, they do.
So
yes,
you have to put the part down and let it cool off?
Or put it in room temperature water, or there's lots of ways around it. But the other thing that people assume is that when you empty pitch, you have to burn it out. And that's not true either.
No, I know.
That's not true at all.
You dissolve it out, right?
I dissolve it out.
Chemically.
Yeah. A lot of people will say, oh, well, you can't, you know, you're bending soft, you're making soft parts because you're using pitch. And that's not true either.
Chris wants to know what the name of Walter's dog is.
Walter's dog?
Yeah, this is a little bit of a break from the discussion about
is
making instruments.
The Big Lebowski?
This is the Big Lebowski, okay, because a minor tune-up is...
Well, first of all, it's not Walter's dog.
It's Cynthia's dog.
Cynthia's dog.
That's right.
So, what is the name?
Because she's off in Honolulu with Marty Ackerman.
Yeah.
They never say his name. I actually know, this is a tiny bit of trivia, that I even got Chris Cromer on.
Sorry, Chris. I don't know what the name of the dog is.
I think we're just going to leave that lie there, because I know the answer, and it's a bit of trivia.
Well, you got me. You got me, Chris.
They never say the dog's name. The dog's name is on a plaque on the carrier when Walter brings him to the bowling alley.
So why do you make coffee this way? Do you do this every day?
I do this every day, multiple times a day.
I first hit when I worked in Jacob's shop with him for a couple days on a horn of his that a customer brought to me. It had gotten pretty badly damaged and had to be fairly substantially rebuilt. And so... Refabricated, yeah.
And I'm going to do this just so I don't have to make another car.
Okay. And that's fine. Anyway, Jacob made pour-over coffee for me while I was there visiting, and this is like the most delicious coffee, like ever. I think, but you like the ritual as well.
I do, I do, I do. I like the. It's very ordered. It's very.
Enjoying my coffee. Uh-huh. What's the answer? Okay, the brass bench asks me, what's the answer? The answer. The dog's name is Thurston. There's a little brass plaque with his name engraved on the carrier.
I would have never gotten that.
It's hard to see, too. I had to rewind the DVD a couple times and make sure it's Thurston.
Well, I love that scene, so normally I'm just giggling over the lawn. So.
Oh, that's your your Radu Rusu mug.
That's right. That's right. I drink out of this, it gets washed a couple times a week, so there are days when I don't drink out. But most of the days, it's this one.
There you go. It's a great mug. He makes great stuff. Not only is he a great horn player, but makes great pottery.
Yeah.
So before that, we're talking about difficult techniques, and
so parts-wise, I would say that long F branch is the most difficult part,
right?
To make, but there's some tough techniques. I mean, all of this brace work I do by hand. I make it exactly to fit.
You can put it down there. All right.
Is it possible to pull the piece that you were talking about out of the horn itself to hold up individually?
No.
For the stream?
No.
Fair enough.
Katie, we're not pulling the horn apart.
Yeah, no. Sorry, yeah.
Now, in fact, that part is pretty darn tough to pull out, even when damaged. It's there's a lot involved.
And actually,
damage happens a lot if you're not careful with your
arm. So this joint right here,
yes.
I think you knew at one point I was making this in a single piece.
Yeah.
And I forgot who said this, but somebody said the only reason to make the piece that
way. I think Balu said that.
Is to just prove that you can.
Is to prove that you can. Yeah.
And I could. But it's this question,
mm-hmm.
you know, because I saw a couple of horns that had some dings up here,
mm-hmm.
had a ding in here,
mm-hmm.
and oh my gosh,
mm-hmm.
that's crazy. I don't know if you know this, but I do a lot of my dent work with ball bearings.
I did know that. Yeah, you did tell me that.
So for me, it's okay because I use a ball bearing. I can get around most of the curves,
mm-hmm.
but. You know, to get a barrel dent ball around some of these curves.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's what I have, barrel dent balls. I really have been thinking about investing in, like, sets of ball bearings for the cylindrical tubes.
There is one company in the country that can get you ball bearings down to, like, 6 decimal places.
Wow. Wow. Do I have to get a whole set?
I don't know.
In increments of hundred thousandths of an inch?
Million thousandths.
Anyway, so yeah, that long tube. Now, as we all know, this wrap of horn, you got a lot of mass in the valve section hanging off of just a few tubes like that.
Yeah.
And if you drop your horn,
mm-hmm.
even in the case, even in your protective case, the case will hold. It will cradle the bell and the lead pipe. But unless that case also stabilizes that valve section
mm-hmm.
and keeps it from moving, that valve section keeps moving because there's so much mass. And it's hanging off these three annealed tubes and, therefore, oftentimes will break right at that long F branch. And if it's a single-piece long F branch, I mean, you got to take a lot of stuff apart. As we well know, remanufactured, blah, 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 blah. It is a lot easier if you have a two-part long F branch
mm-hmm.
to remove that because the long F branch is a kind of a C. And you have to take stuff off because you can't remove a C in one direction. But if you part that and you have it a two-part long F branch, then you can easily remove that part in case of damage.
And replace it
with a fairly short tube. So it's good for repairs.
This brings up another question of, you know, are joints necessarily inherently bad? And
yes, it does. It brings up a real good question.
And they can be. They can be.
Mm-hmm.
Or they can't be. I mean, a well-done joint should not
mm-hmm.
influence the horn, especially since, you know, right up at where that part is,
mm-hmm.
it's soldered to the horn there usually anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the difference of having a joint? Well, a bad joint will, you know, ruin your day pretty much.
When you say a bad joint, are we talking about incomplete solder or what are we talking? What makes a bad joint?
So a lot of guys, and you see this in gals, but a lot of people, especially if you see manufacturing videos,
mm-hmm.
you know, you have the two tubes that go into a joint. And there's a joint.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll see them heat the joint, and they'll take the solder, and they'll go like, blah, 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 blah,
mm-hmm.
and that joint is done.
Right.
And a lot of times when you take those apart, you find that the solder either hasn't penetrated all the way to the middle.
Right.
Or it has, you know, when you create a vacuum on, if you create a seal on one side, and you mm-hmm. start to solder from the other side,
mm-hmm.
and you put too much solder in there, it can't blow out this side. It's just going to blow out into the bore. Of the horn.
So you get a bead, a ball of solder in. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So what you do instead is you have the tubes and you've got the ferrule
mm-hmm.
and you have to make the parts so that they're completely flush.
Mm-hmm.
And then you heat the joint and you basically draw the solder from one side. You put the solder on one side and you draw it all the way through to the other side of the joint. So you draw it over that gap, across that gap.
So the two parts have to fit in the middle.
Yeah, right.
I can tell you right now, most horns.
So this is why there's enough anecdotal evidence out there saying that joints are bad. You see what I'm saying?
Because they're designed bad.
Because they're executed poorly.
Well, I think...
In my opinion.
Well...
For what I think the solder joint ought to do.
Okay. But, you know, if you're making a horn in a large volume environment...
Yeah.
We call them factory-made horns. The fact of the matter is that no matter where the horn is made, it's all hand-assembled. There are no robots.
Right.
There are no machines assembling horns. There's people assembling horns.
That's right.
And in the factory, the horns have to be assembled high volume.
Right.
They have to do it as quickly as possible. Mm-hmm. And if you have two tubes that are butting up against each other with a ferrule, a tube around them to solder and make them one tube, that if you have to meet those two tubes perfectly...
Takes a lot of time. Yeah,
takes a lot of effort. Yeah. So this is one of the differences between, say, you know, a handmade custom horn and like a factory horn.
Well, and this is why I have a problem with when you visually see poor craftsmanship.
Mm-hmm.
Because how do you know that all of those details that you're supposed to be doing better than what you can get in a high volume factory are being taken care of?
Right.
I don't think you can say with certainty that they can be if what you're seeing is something sub what you would get from a factory horn. I mean, I think that, you know, anybody building horns by hand has a minimum of, you know, factory quality. I mean, I think a single person should be able to do what they can do in a factory. It might not be at the volume, but anybody can buy the requisite parts, you know, get a soldering torch from Home Depot and put a horn together. Right?
Don't diss soldering torches from Home Depot.
Well, I'm just saying, okay, from Lowe's.
Okay.
The point is, you can buy solder,
right.
There's nothing preventing anybody from going online, sourcing the parts, soldering them together,
right,
and having a horn.
Well, Mark Atkinson, it's no secret, he actually sells kits.
Yeah.
That you can assemble.
Right.
Make a horn or...
Build a horn.
Build a horn. Yeah. Thank you. Sorry, Mark. Build a horn. And, yeah, anybody can do it.
Yeah.
Why doesn't anybody just do it?
And why is that, as my friend Jenna would say, why is that a bee up my bonnet?
Why is that a bee up your bonnet, Jacob?
Well,
why should it upset you that I would go get a build a horn from Mark?
It doesn't upset me.
Okay.
You can do, you know, everybody can do whatever it is that they...
This is America.
It's your right as an American.
It's your right as a citizen of the world.
That's right. But, you know, the reason is, if you're going to charge a premium price,
right,
I believe you have a responsibility, you know, to really put some time, some effort, and some research and some knowledge and skill into these things. You know, I have no problems with people that you know, do it for fun.
Okay.
You know, like I said, anybody can do their business. But this particular model of, we'll call it a business. Everybody knows that, you know, it's a living. But
if you call that living.
This particular model of single craftsmen in single shops.
Single craftsmen shop. Bespoke, I like to call it sometimes.
This can only exist because the people in those shops are doing something more than what's available to people. Because, I mean, they're expensive and they take forever. I mean, you know, and for me personally, I rely on people like Katie to trust me enough to be patient with me and let me do what I'm my best work, when I'm capable of doing, when I'm my best.
Right.
I rely on that from people.
So your feeling is that the single person shop, the what we like to call custom horn maker sometimes, although I know you don't necessarily care for that.
I do not like the word custom.
Okay.
I think it's a cop out.
Okay. But the person such as yourself should be adding some value beyond what you get from a factory made horn. I mean, and not just a little bit of value.
Right.
I mean, really adding like deep research, deep knowledge and understanding, skills.
Yeah.
Well beyond.
I would agree with that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is. Are you saying this doesn't exist?
No, I'm saying that you know, people. people should just be aware that when they buy horns made from this model of doing business,
right,
that, you know, it's their responsibility to determine the skill level of...
Well, but see, that this is kind of one of the things that I want to tease out here, which is that, as I've said before, I look at your horn and I can't see, you know, like all the stress relief factors, and right. I can see that there are the way the tubes enter and so forth and so on. I've seen it taken apart. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know the way the joints are really beautifully fitted and the way the tubes are really beautifully fitted. And there's no wiring the parts together until they get aligned and then soldering,
right,
which just leaves lots of stresses in the horn. I mean, they're soldered so that there are no stresses. But the average buyer can't see that. They go up and they say, oh, well, that looks like this other guy's horn.
Yeah.
How do they know? Or do they know? Can they know?
I don't know that they can. And I think this is when it's important to know that there's, you know, we're not a regulated industry.
No.
I mean, there's no, you know, there's not a craftsmanship police that is going to come and say, you know, I'm sorry, this is unacceptable. Really, this is what market pressure is supposed to do. Yeah.
You get a ticket.
Yeah. So
incomplete joint.
But this is part of the problem, mm-hmm, is most of the really, really, really good craftsmen that I know, mm-hmm, like Rick.
Mm-hmm.
Rick rarely leaves his shop. You know, Rick is not on Facebook. Rick does not, you know, he does not fly banners and things like that about. So, you know, how is it?
Have I ever seen Rick at a show with this stuff? I guess a couple shows.
Yeah, he comes to.
I think he's actually listed to go to IHS this year, or somebody is going to be.
Somebody might be.
When is IHS this year?
Hang on. I will go back to my notes. International Horn Society. That's June. Oh, sorry. Yes, June 13 to 18, Ithaca College, Ithaca, New York.
So the question is, how do you know? And
how do you know? Yes, that was the question.
And that's kind of my question too. What is it? What is it that, I mean, would people, you know, when I seriously want to know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, would people rather me, you know, go out all over town, or would they rather me
sit my butt in the shop
and
work. Get her done. Yeah.
And you know, it's a challenge. It's a challenge for me and my business.
Mm-hmm.
And you know this.
I do.
I do know this.
Well,
craftsmanship should work with their hands, not with their mouth.
Okay.
I mean,
fair enough.
Yeah, that's what I believe.
Okay.
And so, you know, given that I've made the choice to do that,
mm-hmm,
I just have to be okay with the fact that, you know, that people may not understand what I do to the level that I might want them to.
If I may offer a suggestion, not to you, but in general,
yeah,
to the general listening, whoever, when you look at a horn,
mm-hmm,
like I'm sitting here just like gazing at your horn, that there are indications, I think, a lot of times.
Yes.
That a horn, you can see stuff that's, mm-hmm, poorly done.
Mm-hmm.
That will affect the way the horn plays, and probably gives an indication that the stuff you can't see is also.
Yeah.
And I mean, would you say that's a fair statement?
I would say it's a fair statement, and I have some pet ones.
There
that
we
I look
go.
For.
What is it that you look for when you pick up a horn? You're looking at somebody else's work, and you're like, you're checking. You get mental checklist. What I can see,
mm-hmm,
I see this, and this. What's that?
The first thing I check for is architecture.
Okay.
And that is, when I look at a horn, how much bracing is used and where is it used?
Mm-hmm.
Because I can tell you from a lot and lots and lots and lots of time spent researching in big halls that if you want projection,
uh-huh,
you need architecture. And when I mean by architecture, I mean the brace work in here, how the horn sits, where everything is together.
Mm-hmm.
I consider these long joints to be part of this question of architecture.
Mm-hmm.
I want to see long joints. I want to see thin joints.
Okay.
Second thing, I always look for tuning slides to have braces in the crooks. And the reason is, it's hard. This is hard.
this is hard to build a tuning slide with a brace in it and keep it parallel. I mean, you can build a perfectly reasonable tuning slide, put a brace in there, and have the ends pull together, you know, 10,000, right?
10,000ths is a lot for those who don't know.
Yeah, that's enough to really,
you know, hundredths of an inch is it's visible.
Yes, yeah. It's like, what is a sheet of paper, like 1.5 thou?
About that, yeah.
My aluminum foil is right around one.
Yeah. A mil.
A mil. In the biz.
In the biz.
In the biz, we say mil. So when I see those left out, that makes me wonder about the paralleling of this particular section of the architecture. Because a lot of times what you can do is, if you leave these braces out, you can put the tuning slide crook, you can put it in, and the actual crook here will flex. It'll flex in and out. And so it feels like it runs really smooth. But what you're not seeing is you're not seeing the flex in the crook. Okay. So you might slide it all the way down there and then have it flex like this, and you can never tell. I prefer having these double braces in here. Sometimes you only see one, and that makes me sort of wonder if that was a decision based on, you know, that was the best playing thing that was discovered.
Right.
Or if it was just because, you know, it's actually pretty difficult to put the second one in. I mean, the first one always goes in great, beautifully.
Yeah.
And then the second one, when you put the second one
in. Yeah,
yeah. It's a little bit of a ring.
Let me tell you how hard it can be on damaged horns, too.
I believe it.
Yes.
I believe it.
Yeah, getting parts to fit again after they've been mangled. And because it's not just one part. I mean, it looks like it's one part that's broken.
Yeah.
But it's really several parts that have been flexed, broken, bent. The whole, you know, everything's at a different angle.
And I'm sure you know this, too. If you take a horn apart that has been sort of manufactured poorly, and you start to put it together the way you know it needs to be put together.
Right, right.
By the time you get to the last part, it doesn't fit by a mile. It's like, you know.
It's so true.
It's like all the way over here, and it needs to be over here.
Yeah,
you've got to rebend it or whatever.
Yeah.
So that's what I always check the bell cut. I'm a believer. I think detachable bells are, I mean, I know people have debate over detached versus fixed bell.
Right.
For me personally, I think it's, my decision was to just go ahead and make the detachable bell. That's just what I'm going to do. And if I have to make any design considerations later to balance it, I will.
Right.
I will.
Right.
And I like it better.
Okay.
I like it better.
But. All right. Great. You know, let's get back to the second part of Jeffrey's question. That was the first part of Jeffrey's question all the way up to this point.
Oh my gosh.
Really? Elements of a Schmidt wrap without the piston valve. So in other words, I assume that means four rotors. Can you do a Schmidt wrap with four rotors or with something other than not a piston? Because that piston is really hard to reach.
So I have seen a lot of people attempt the piston CF Schmidt horn, and they'll move the piston inside the horn here.
Right.
And they'll put a lever here.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, I suppose that works. You know, the piston is a long part.
Mm-hmm.
Part of the problem is, you know, if you have a rotor, you got to somehow get the tube back up to the top of the valves, and the piston does it actually pretty well. The thing I love about those CF Schmidt horns is you look at them and they are just absolutely dead simple. They're gorgeous. The simplicity of those. Of that wrap is really, really cool.
Stunning.
Yeah, yeah. You know, there's one tuning slide loop, and there's one F loop, and that's it. It's awesome. But it requires the geometry of the piston to be able to pull that off.
Right.
I don't think you can pull that off with a rotor unless you were to do.
Does the piston placement have anything to do with the taper of the horn? Does it affect it?
You know, I don't know. I have never pulled out a branch on a Schmidt horn and measured the taper to see if it is a continual taper all the way down.
Right.
I'm guessing I would find that it probably is.
Mm-hmm.
But because the piston is all the way up here And to a certain extent, this is true on crisp-wrapped horns, too, where
the change valve
is up here. The first branch taper can come, like, super, 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 super long, which is pretty cool.
The first branch, just terminology-wise, is the first tapered tube after the valve section. On any brass instrument that has valves, you have a tapered section, a cylindrical section, or possibly a dual bore section, but generally it's cylindrical, and then you have another tapered section after the cylindrical section.
Right.
I have a question. What is the between all horns, as a generalism, what do you find is the part that is manufactured and or engineered differently, like per horn? Like, what is the most variable?
Oh, that's a good question. What's the biggest variability?
Biggest variability?
Which also will lead into what can you vary to change the characteristics of the horn?
Biggest variable.
Yeah.
I would say for most people it's the construction. The level of construction that goes into
That's more like inconsistency than consistency than variability. What's the difference? Yeah, exactly. What's the difference?
Has my collar been up like this the whole time?
I haven't noticed.
Oh, well.
You look great either way.
Oh, Dave. Oh, stop. So, for example.
Yeah.
Depending on who has scraped from horn to horn of a single manufacturer, the horns vary wildly depending on how well the scraping was done. You know, how many solder crowns and everything were done.
A solder crown is the leftover.
Can you point to where some of this stuff is on the horn as you're explaining?
Well, a solder crown would be a leftover bead of solder at outside of a joint.
Yeah. Yeah. So where the solder has sort of creeped. And
solder joint.
Well, and this goes up to whether or not using leaded or unleaded solder.
Right. You use a high tensile strength.
Yes, I use a non-leaded
super duper
solder, and the problem with that is, with a lead solder, you can buff
the
solder away.
I know.
You cannot do that with.
You can't. You'll buff the brass away before you buff away the solder.
You will. If you don't get it all, you'll leave little pits where it was, and then you know you have the divots. But, Rick taught me that. Rick taught me to use it. I have to say,
are we giving it away? Does Rick, you know what solder Rick uses? Does he use?
Yeah, he
silver bearing solder. Uses
it. This is actually what I believe.
Non-leaded solder.
I believe this is the same stuff that Keith Berg uses.
Okay,
I could be wrong, but I remember various.
I only use it in certain circumstances when
it's
I need
tough.
When I need, it's very tough.
It's tough to use,
and when I need very high tensile strength, small surface area part that's got some, you know. Leverage on it like a key saddle with a spring, that sort of thing. Use it in those situations or very small surface area, not like super small where you have to braze. That's high temperature silver soldering.
And you know the higher strength you have in the joints, the less solder you can use to have, you know. I always say, you know, my horns should last 100 years without breaking any joints.
How will I know?
Well, that's exactly part of it. It's like,
I ain't going to be around to find out. Exercise that warranty.
That's right.
Nor will you, probably.
When it comes to the flare of the actual bell, when we're coming up, to the actual bell part of it, do you find, is there any kind of variation at all? Or is that like extremely standard measurements and in like, exponential flare as it goes out.
Well,
is there like specific numbers for that, or do they vary slightly? And if they do vary, what are the variable ranges that we're looking at?
Well, I think you're talking model to model there.
Well, and actually, I think you could expand that to include tapers just in general.
Tapers in general, yeah.
And my opinion of that is, you know, the tapers are. And I know this is a controversial statement, but I think the tapers are less important than being able to control the way the horn physically vibrates.
Yeah, that is a controversial statement. Because some people say the taper is everything.
Yeah, some people say that the taper is everything. But I can tell you, I mean, I can build 30 variations on this horn just this horn.
So if a customer comes in and says, well, you know, I do this kind of playing, and I do, you know, I like this kind of sound coloration, you can actually vary mm-hmm. components and or construction of the horn
yeah.
to get them what they want.
Yep.
Okay?
Yep.
So what about like nickel silver slide stockings versus brass slide stockings? Is this a big component?
So this
is these are nickel silver.
So this is a special alloy actually that I buy from a tube mill.
Special.
This is not the normal nickel silver that you could buy regularly.
And you also have a rolled ends, I see.
I do have rolled ends. I kind of like them. I like them. And
the roll here is a little bead that the tube has been literally rolled over, and it creates strength right there. And it yep. also creates a nice angle for the slide to actually enter without mm-hmm. Needing to flex the slide. And it just goes right in, pulls right out.
Which, if I've done my paralleling correctly, would not matter
at all
with a raw tube anyway. But the nickel question, I use a nickel alloy that is brass-ish.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I think the differences between my horns in nickel and the horns in brass mm-hmm. are maybe less pronounced than, you know, super high content nickel
and
brass. But even then, mm-hmm. I think that the differences are minute.
Well, let's talk just a few minutes, because we're getting a little long in the show. But let's talk a few minutes about tooling and paralleling. And one of the things that I've noticed that distinguishes some makers versus others are the actual ability to make the tooling that you need to do a particular job. So, for example, I spent some time in Walt Lawson's shop
mm-hmm.
out in Boonesboro, Maryland, and they could make tooling mm-hmm. to do things
yeah.
that they needed to do. You could make tooling.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to talk about paralleling in particular?
Sure. Well,
it is an amazingly hard thing to do.
It is really hard.
And it's amazing to me how much variation there is, even in like well-known manufacturers.
Yes. Yeah.
That you will find that your slides and your slide stockings are not quite as parallel as you assume they are.
And you know, there's a question to ask about, you know, is it really all that important?
Right.
And the reason that I spend so much time on it is that, you know, the more parallel...
I'm going to move the horn so you have room to bring the tools in.
The more parallel that you can make a slide, the tighter the tolerances you can use for your in and out of slide tubes. Oh, this is just a smattering.
A smattering.
A smattering.
Well,
of,
it's probably good enough.
Let's of
smatter.
Stuff. But, you know, the other reason that I think it's important to be able to make tubing, other mm-hmm. than to be able to say I can make tooling, mm-hmm. no, tooling,
mm-hmm. Tooling,
is that it's really, really expensive to do prototyping.
Yes.
If you cannot personally make tools that you need, because, you know, you could spend, you know, like a tube die or something.
Mm-hmm.
You could spend $300 a pop mm-hmm. on these tube dies, mm-hmm. and you end up spending $1,000, and it still doesn't even work the way that you thought it would.
Right.
And
right.
I know,
and
all
it takes
the time,
a lot of time too to get.
Yeah,
you're
talking
about made from a custom tool
shop.
Yeah,
like if you send something out to be
right.
to be machined, mm-hmm. and you know, sometimes there are parts that in my mind go a certain way, and despite I have to make tools in like, you know, four or five different variations, even to figure out, okay, this is sort of the style of tooling that I need to investigate.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, you make five or six things and one of them might work, and you have a big, you know, you've just added $3 to your steel scrap bin.
So you want to talk about any of the tools that you've developed here, or I'll leave that up to you.
Well, so this is my super high-tech slide paralleler. Which is, I mean, it doesn't look like much.
No, I tell you, that's genius. That is genius.
You know what I do a lot of is I am constantly making scrapers.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And the reason is,
those are your hones. Your
oh yes, these
your,
are
your diamond sharpeners, are, I should
are,
say.
These are hones, but like, you know, here's a scraper that I made.
Well, that's a thing of beauty.
Here's one I made to test this sort of curved angle. And this is a shape that I need rarely, but when I need it, there's nothing else that'll
It's
work.
Not triangular, it's actually
it is
quadrangular.
Triangular. Yeah. Triangular scrapers, I think, are not the right
not the right
You're
tool.
Ripping on me.
Well, no, I mean,
no, but no, but you have a reason for this.
For me.
You know, you have a reason for this. Yeah.
Because when you scrape a joint that's mm-hmm. been done with this kind of solder, mm-hmm. you have to absolutely scrape everything off mm-hmm. before you can finish.
Mm-hmm.
So a triangular scraper, to me, leaves a lot of gouge marks.
It does.
If you're going to scrape all the way down.
And then you have to go after those gouge marks, and now you're taking away metal.
Now you're taking away more
yep.
and more.
Yep. Oh, metal. Look at that.
So this is the pointy one.
So this is you used to do knife making, or you were a knife aficionado?
I dabbled in it. I have some knives that I have made.
Okay. But these skills are serving you. Again, it's a matter of skills.
Are the knives made of brass?
Brass?
No, they're steel. They're steel. But it's a really cool, craft again. Some of these are just brought. Here's another one of the scrapers.
All right. I am going to ask anybody who happens to be watching right now, do we have any questions for Jacob? Questions for me? Type it in the chat, and we'll respond. Because I don't think we're going to be, I don't think the show is going to go on too much longer. It's not a hard end, but I think we're kind of exhausting. Is there anything else you want to share?
No, for me, I'm appreciative of the opportunity to, you know, have a safe place to, you know.
This is your safe space?
Well, no, to most of us, and actually all of the people in this business that are really, really good.
Yeah.
Are really, really bad at the business, and they're really bad at marketing, and they're really bad at these other things. And that's one of these problems is, if you want to be really, really good at the actual thing that you're doing, you have to leave some of those other things behind.
Mm-hmm. So a minor tune-up wants to know, what stone do you prefer to shape your scrapers?
I know that diamond plate on some of the various steels is controversial, but I really like the diamond.
I have those
stones.
Diamond on steel.
They're generally flat.
But these are for edges, right? These are progressively fine.
Yes.
For
the shaping, I use a grinder.
Regular old grinder stone, like yarn.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So you do all of the shaping, and then you use a really coarse diamond plate to get the angles and everything that you need, and then mm-hmm. you know you can stone them in various ways.
Okay. So, now and you do you sharpen your stuff every day?
Yes.
Every day. I'm not as assiduous about it as you, but you have gotten me into the habit of keeping the edges in far better shape.
Well, this is, you know, for me, this goes, I mean, these are all related.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if I am expecting someone to invest time and money in what I'm doing in my work,
mm-hmm.
I really think I owe them the absolute best finishes and things that I can manage.
Right.
And for me, the best finishes are with sharper tools.
Okay, minor tune-up says green wheel.
So that's a silicone carbide.
Oh, the silicone
wheel,
carbide.
And I don't. I use mostly aluminum oxide stuff. There's a very specific white wheel that has been recommended.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very
that's not
specific.
Aluminum oxide, is it? The white wheel.
The white wheel. My white wheel is.
Oh, okay. Aluminum oxide. Okay. The green wheel is silicone carbide, which is harder.
Usually. The aluminum oxide. The silicone carbide wheels. The green wheels are really good for carbide bits and things like that. But the thing about the silicone carbide wheels is they tend to not hold their shape as much. Mm-hmm. So that's just my
preference.
There
you go.
Plus, I'm not terribly interested in spending like $400.
Are you using mostly high-speed steel to make your scrapers then?
I use a lot of high-speed steel, and I do a lot of oil hardening tool steel as well. Some of these custom,
like when you want to harden your edge.
Well, if you want to make any sort of custom shapes, mm-hmm. you have to bend it first, and you have to do all of the initial profile grinding.
Oh yeah,
first.
Yeah, we can't.
And then harden.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
But like
nothing happening after you harden it.
Some of these the high speed steel, like to grind these into the profiles,
mm-hmm.
takes forever.
Don't I know it? Don't I know
to start
it?
Start from there, but
yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't know. I like the flexibility. It means that I can do something that a manufacturer can't, which is that if I have an idea, mm-hmm. I can test it immediately.
Right.
I can make changes to my designs. I can do whatever I want right away.
Let's, before we end, let's talk about lead pipes. What do you think?
I suppose we should touch on lead pipes.
Well, because you have been working on some new lead pipe tapers. Am I wrong?
You're not wrong.
Am I wrong?
You're not wrong. You're not wrong. Lead pipes. So I did this. Sometimes I say I did this backwards.
Okay.
I focused for years and years and years and years mm-hmm. on the construction, on the architecture.
Right.
On.
I'd say you have that down pretty well.
Well, that's very nice of you to say, Dave. Yeah. Thank you. So that was my initial focus.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, I found enough variation
mm-hmm.
that I could achieve with that to keep me, beyond. And we should also mention the different heat treatments.
Heat treatments, yeah. You worked on those a lot.
I did a lot of work on those. And those were not related to the papers.
Right.
So, now I am, I am dabbling in... tapers. It's not mm-hmm. that I don't think that they have an effect.
Mm-hmm.
That would be an incorrect statement. Mm-hmm. I believe they have an effect.
Mm-hmm.
But I believe that mediocre tapers, and not to say that my tapers are mediocre, but you could take mediocre tapers and build an excellent horn more easily than you could take great tapers, put it together in a mediocre way, and get
a great horn. Okay.
That's my personal
belief. Okay.
So
But you've identified just a few variations.
Well, so
in what you can do with a lead pipe of a given length, is that correct?
Yes. So if you make certain assumptions about the lead pipes,
mm-hmm.
and I think that the Lawson lead pipe
mm-hmm.
paper,
mm-hmm.
I mean that it's the most information about lead pipes that anyone's ever actually bothered to publish. Right.
Right.
So, if you read that paper and you understand it the same way that I do, and mm-hmm. you make the same assumptions that he makes in
right.
the paper,
right?
And you map out all of the variations, and you make certain
right.
other assumptions,
right?
You can really sort of take the number of possible lead pipe numbers, mm-hmm. generate a list of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
You can take that down from a 6,000 million. To about 8. And then you can basically take every lead pipe that comes off a horn and match it up, not perfectly obviously, but mm-hmm. match it up pretty closely with one of those tapers.
So there are just a few variations that work, is what you're saying.
Well, I don't know if they work. I haven't made all of them.
Okay, so yet, you're working on the tooling right now.
No, but yes, I am building the tooling right now. But to come up with a sets of numbers that fit the set of assumptions that Lawson has written in those papers.
So when you're done making the tooling, you're going to test the tapers that you draw see if these work.
Sure.
So you're doing the research.
Right.
And development. There you go.
And the building. And the coffee making.
That's the most important part day to day.
Yeah.
All right. So I think we're going to wrap it up. We've been going on for quite a while now.
Really?
Yeah.
Boy, it seems like 2 minutes.
We could go on all day long. But everybody else has things to do, too. So I think we're going to wrap it up. We'll have you on again. Yeah?
Thanks.
Absolutely. Well,
yeah.
This is great.
Yeah.
I could have you on every week.
Okay.
We could just go on and on and on.
On and on.
If you want to drive up here, maybe we'll have to figure out a way to live stream from your shop. And then I'll drive down there. All right.
Or Skype it. I can be a headless.
We're working on can we get a quality Skype guest yeah. appearance? That would open up the possibility of guests to me.
Well, I have to say that, I'm more than happy. I love to talk about this stuff.
Great.
And this is what I do. I mean, this is what I spend my day.
It's all you doing. Well, you do a few other things though.
Yeah, I mean, I play a little bit and do some
play
other
a little
stuff,
bit,
but
yeah.
I mean, this
keep
is
keep your hand in.
This is my wheel.
Great. All right. So, anyway, I think we are going to wrap it up.
Let's
think that's
do it.
Yeah, that's about it. This is Jacob Medlin. Medlin Horns.
Thank you Greensboro, very much.
North Carolina. Thank you,
Thanks
Jacob.
For having me.
Jacob, my good friend Jacob, who has like an awesome shop, Greensboro. Check out his website, Medlin, M-E-D-L-I-N, MedlinHorns.com. A lot of information there, and you can get in touch with Jacob.
Please do. And I'm happy to have these conversations over the phone, too, or not email. I don't like to type in.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So anyway, this is The Brass Bench. This show has been brought to you by Brass Arts Unlimited. That's my store. Blah, 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 blah. BrassArts.com. You don't want to hear all that stuff. I also have a Facebook page, Brass Arts Unlimited. And you can tweet me. You can send me a tweet. Brass_Arts, @Brass_Arts. Show's also brought to you by A Minor Tune-Up, Trumpet and Brass Wind Services in Wilmington, Delaware. Our good friend Chris Cromer has joined us today in the chat. So next week, May 7th, we're going to live stream on this YouTube channel at 9 a.m. Eastern Daylight Savings Time. That's Universal Time Coordinated, minus 4 hours, from here in Lutherville, Maryland. And I will be joined by Chris Cromer, owner of and chief everything of A Minor Tune-Up, Trumpet and Brass Wind Services.
These also include janitorial services.
Absolutely.
As well. I know
we do everything.
Chris,
you know, we're going to talk about red rot. We're going to talk about why it attacks your horn, what it is, how to prevent it. We're going to do some bench demos, I think, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. If you want to suggest a topic of conversation, if you want to get a hold of us in any way in between live streams and you don't want to or can't be on the live chat, you guys at thebrassbench.com. That's YOUGUYS at thebrassbench.com. Follow us on our website, www.thebrassbench.com, or our Facebook page, same name. You're watching our YouTube channel. We hope you're going to join us again. There's a little red button near that says subscribe. Please subscribe. And this show is a production of Brass Arts Unlimited and 12 Tides. Our associate producer and director is Adam Weiner of 12 Tides. Our theme song is Ricochet, written by Carrie Turner. I'm Dave Weiner with Jacob Medlin. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time when we meet again at the Brass Bench.